I'm Al McFarland. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarland, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarland and jazz. Check him out.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Programming is supported by UCare, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCare. Healthcare that starts with you.
I'm Al McFarland. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarland, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House in Minneapolis. I'm pleased to have as guest two leaders of legacy institutions that serve the Twin Cities Black community. Cindy Booker is the leader, the CEO of Sabathany Community Center, a legacy institution, a great story, a great service provider, a great convener of our community and of our agencies. And Jonathan Palmer is the leader at Hallie Hugh Brown Community Center. My program today really wants to acknowledge the tremendous and important work of institutions that you lead, of Sabathany in particular, and of Hallie Hugh Brown. We may be joined later by Steve Belton from the Minneapolis Urban League, but I always refer to you as the legacy institutions, and I think our community sees you that way. I wanted to take this time to ask you, Cindy, and you, Jonathan, to take a minute to refresh our community on the value proposition. Sabathany, because some people might not know the history and the work of the organization. They know it, they see it, they use it, but they might not know the story, and if we don't tell it, it won't be told. Tell the story. What's the Sabathany story?
Sabathany, we're going to celebrate our 50th anniversary next year, 2016, and we're going to, since it's such a great event, we're going to extend the celebration to about a year and a half. Mm-hmm. But Sabathany was founded in 1966 by some concerned church African Americans about having opportunities for youth in the community to make sure that youth would have an opportunity to go have fun, but then also have some type of academic learning. And then once they started the youth program, then they found out that, you know what, people are hungry in the community. We were one of the first organized food shelves in Minneapolis. Today, we're one of the largest food shelf in Minneapolis, and we serve about 7% of Minneapolis population. Mm-hmm. And so we still have our youth program and then the senior program, 55 plus. That program is going strong, as well as some of our new programs, health and wellness, fitness. And we just recently started a jobs program training, and we're seeing some great success stories out of that. Mm-hmm. And we've only started that in the last 60 days, but we've already have four students that have graduated, and they are making at least $30,000 a year after only 3 weeks of training. So it's exciting. It's a great place to work.
Mm-hmm. So you've got a great institution, the former Bryant School,
yeah.
3810 East 38th Street in South Minneapolis. It's an iconic location. Talk about your facility and the concept. Here's how I see it, and you can correct me or build on it. I see it as an agency that has a facility resource that has its own programs, but also is home and hosts other community and agency programs. And it's a place where people from the neighborhood and businesses and churches can also gather and do things. Is that a good description?
That's an outstanding description. And I always say when I meet people, I know even before I worked at Sabathany, I had a Sabathany story. Mm-hmm. Everyone that you meet in South Minneapolis and even beyond will have a Sabathany story. Mm-hmm. We have about 35 nonprofit tenants in the building, and they have very various services that we might work with on partnerships. But that's where we'll also draw people. Like you said, it's former junior high school, so mm-hmm. of course we have an auditorium, mm-hmm. a gym, a banquet room. Mm-hmm. So it's a great facility, and we're very blessed to have that corner spot. And a lot of people don't know the all of the story to Sabathia of how we came to own that building. Mm-hmm. But we are very excited from the various donations, and one in particular was from Lund's in the 60s mm-hmm. That put us in the position to buy that building.
Okay. And before, Sabathia was located at 31st and 1st, I believe.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So let me tell you a Sabathia story. You said everybody. I got a Sabathia story. Here's my Sabathia story. Sabathia is where I met my wife and my life partner, Bobby Ford McFarland. And the story is that I went to a meeting, a community meeting that was being held there, presided over by Harry Davis.
Yes.
Harry Davis,
yes.
Like the godfather of the black community.
Absolutely.
The dean.
Yes.
And I was a new young guy in the community, active in media. And I think at that time I might have been working at General Mills. And I was walking in the room when he was introducing some of the new young people in the community. He said, Al McFarland. So I just to walk out in the middle, take a quick bow. You know, I'm 24 or 5 years old. It's pretty cool. And out of the corner of my eye, I see these three halos bouncing around, silhouetted by the sun, from the southern sun. And one of the halos, a brilliant, beautiful red afro, real red afro, happened to be Bobby.
Wow.
Bobby. And so I met her sometime later, but I said, I remember you because you made an impression on my spirit. And so that's my Sabathia story. So Sabathia is special to me. Everybody's got a story, right?
Everyone has a story.
Yeah.
My story is I received my first three employment opportunities, not working at Sabathia, right. But just coming to Sabathia, receiving services. I was able to get three professional jobs just from the networking at Sabathia.
Yeah. And so to me, all of this sort of underlines the point of this conversation, the story. Institutions like Sabathia, institutions like MLK, Hallie Q. Brown and St. Paul, are fundamental places for the life of the people of our community. And it's not just services, it's actually community building, it's community healing, serving each other, realizing our commitments, our connections, our capacity to engage and to be community. That's what I think this is all about. Jonathan, you know, the Hallie Q. Brown MLK is a wonderful resource for our community in St. Paul. It has a great story as well.
Yes, it's very interesting because I think that's a characteristic of the legacy institutions is when I started there, nobody I met didn't have a Hallie Q story, and it started out. We were founded in 1929 when St. Paul was largely still segregated, and African Americans didn't have access to a lot of places and resources, so a number of organizations came together, including the St. Paul Urban League, the St. Paul NAACP, the YWCA, and said, we need one organization that does it all. And we were born out of that. And so a number of groups coming together to make sure that people had resources, make sure people were able to connect. One of the very interesting things, we come out of the settlement house mm-hmm. movement, and we're able to connect people to resources. But what we've tried to do is help people understand that we're an African-American institution, mm-hmm. but we're open to everybody.
Right.
That people sometimes think, African-American, that means you only serve African-Americans. No, we're showing you that the needs we have are the same as everybody's. Mm-hmm. And so over time, we've been a very diverse center, mm-hmm. primarily focused on the African-American community, but our early learning center was a New Deal program. And so if you look at pictures from the 30s, you see black kids and white kids together, you know, playing, having good times, reading stories. Mm-hmm. One of the hard parts of our history is the destruction of the Rondo neighborhood. So we were right there in the heart of Rondo. We've been the historic gathering place in St. Paul for the African-American community. And when the highway came through, it decimated the community.
Well, 60, what? 2, 3, 4?
Yep. Mm-hmm. And so what we came out with is the Martin Luther King Center, which is where we're located. It was a project between us and the city of St. Paul to try to preserve some of the heritage, some of the legacy. The Hallie Q actually paid for a third of the project and then partnered with the city on one of the first HUD Neighborhood Service Center grants in the 60s for the other two-thirds. And so it's a city-owned building, but Hallie owns some of the land around the building. And then we partner together to deliver the services, very similar to Sabathany's food shelf and clothing closet, youth programs, the Early Learning Center.
So there's an equity proposition in terms of the real estate.
Yes.
With you and with you. Your real estate is owned by your board, is that correct?
That's correct.
Yeah, and that's important, is having the title to the deed. It makes all the difference in
yes.
the world. So talk about the programs at MLK. Go into what all you're doing at MLK, Hallie Curran. People call you MLK and Hallie
yeah.
Curran, and it's interchangeable.
Yeah, it very much is. I mean, the building itself is the MLK Center, mm-hmm. but Hallie administers it on behalf of the partnership with the city, mm-hmm. and so many people, especially people who grew up in the original location, just refer to it as Hallie Q. Mm-hmm. Some people will refer to it as MLK, and it does both. We have five core areas, early childhood education. So we have Early Learning Center, as I said, started that as a New Deal program. It goes from 6 weeks on up to 5 years, nationally accredited, NAICI, four-star parent aware rating. And it works on a sliding fee scale. So we work with families who are in need. A lot of our families are either on scholarship or they're on county assistance or something along those lines. And that's one of the areas we specialize in, is making sure people are getting quality education. We have a youth enrichment program. So after they graduate from the Early Learning Center, they'll go maybe to the Rondo Education Center or some of the other schools in St. Paul, and they come back for before and after school care or summer programming. We have basic needs, which is primarily food shelf, clothing closet, focus in on making sure we have wraparound services for families. Two senior programs, our golden agers and our retired men. They are largely some of the people who grew up in the center or may have worked in the center or the community, but they're open. We have several new members who were they were looking for a good senior program and actually have become more diverse. We've been very happy with the number of non-African Americans who have now joined the program sure. to be a part of this and found a home there and very happy. And the stories you get mm-hmm. out of those gentlemen or those ladies is incredible. And then the last area is very similar to again, Sabathany. We call it multi-service center administration, which basically means we have a number of programs that come into the center, are located at the center, and we help coordinate them for delivery to the community. So we have two partners, the City of St. Paul and Penumbra Theater. Penumbra is a nationally known African-American theater. Actually began as an after-school program of Hallie's, but Lou Bellamy and now Sarah Bellamy grew it beyond what anybody dreamed. They've done a phenomenal job in making that a world-class theater. But we also have other programs. We partner with people like Prepare and Prosper that do free tax preparation. Project Cheer, we've been partnering for 40 years. It's free music lessons to low-income families. Parks and Recreation does a lot of the typical things that you find in St. Paul parks, activities and things like that. So,
what about Sabathany? Go into more detail on some of the programs that you have. What are your basic areas?
We have the family resources is where the food shelf and the clothes closet, but you know, very similar to your community center as well, where we have tax services, mm-hmm. you know, toys for tots, we give away backpacks and what have you. So anything really that the community needs, we try to provide, and if we can't provide it, we try to partner with other organizations so that it can come about.
Okay. So what is the challenge of running an organization? Money is always a challenge. And in the economy that we've just come out of, the recession, the Great Recession, a lot of organizations took hits. I think that some of the hits delivered to our community were in addition to or beyond that could be expected because of the general recession. I think there had been, maybe it's changing now, an effort to almost derail and devalue the work that black people provide to the black community through black-led institutions. And what has happened from my point of view is that people say, you know what, these guys are providing services, there's obviously a need, and maybe we should figure out how we can do that and get the revenue streams associated with those services. So they create both a process that tries to criticize what we have done historically to minimize the value, the legacy, the history, and the importance of our engagement, and then suggest that all that history has no meaning, no value, let's start fresh. And they'll say that, you know, these organizations have been getting, you know, funding, say, since 23, funding since, 70? Yeah. And they'll say, we still got problems, and we shouldn't keep putting money in those organizations, right? What they don't say is that we've been running this city for 1,000 years, right, or for 200 years, and nobody is holding us accountable for the poverty that we have maintained and managed, and that we allow to exist, you know. So am I talking out of school here? I think I'm trying to get a reaction here.
No, and I'll jump in with a story I have. And it was a couple years ago, I went before the city's capital improvements budget committee. It's a place where the institutions will present projects, ask for requests. Took in a request for the center to go ahead and do improvements within the center. It's a citizen committee, so the people that are doing that are people who have been appointed. And I did a presentation. I talked about the diversity of the center. I showed pictures from the Early Learning Center. I showed our staff, which is very diverse. And one of the representatives raised their hand and said, okay, so you're a black center. That means you only serve black people. So why should the city give money to a racist institution? So I explained, well, actually, no, we are an African-American institution. That's our heritage. But we serve everybody. Mm-hmm. Anybody that walks through our doors, mm-hmm. they get served. We work to meet their needs. And as you can see from the pictures I've showed, we actually have a very diverse staff. Mm-hmm. That gentleman decided to double down and continued along the same line of, well, but if you're only serving black people and you're black people, you can't understand the needs, and it means that you are against white people. And I had to respond a couple more times before it was interceded. Mm-hmm. Now, to the credit, I mean, the mayor was horrified by that. I got a really great letter from him apologizing on behalf of that. And I got the same a call from the committee. And that was one individual with their own pen, but that is the perspective mm-hmm. that tends to be out there about our institutions, that somehow if you're black, it's less than, it only serves this compartment. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't necessarily support that. Mm-hmm. It's one of the things that needs to be broken out of people's minds mm-hmm. because they paint us all with that same brush.
Mm-hmm. I'm Al McFarland. This is Conversations with Al McFarland. Continue with Jonathan Palmer, the leader at Hallie Q. Brown Center in St. Paul, and Cindy Booker, who heads Sabathany Community Center in South Minneapolis, in just a minute. Come back. I'm Al McFarland. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarland here at Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. Pleased to have Jonathan Palmer, who's the CEO of Hallie Q. Brown Community Center in St. Paul, and his colleague, Cindy Booker, the CEO, president of Sabathany Community Center in South Minneapolis, both important legacy institutions. So I want to have this conversation that we were on before the break. You know, I am always concerned that there is an undercurrent that devalues black participation in building and serving the black community. And when I say the black community, I speak from the position that I'm not just talking about black folks. The black community, from my point of view, is consistent with our view. When we say black, we mean inclusive. Mm-hmm. Everybody, you can be white and a member of the black community, and nobody's going to say you're not. You can be Asian, Latino. It's a question of your attitude and your perception and perspective. And the defining characteristic is your ability to value a person's humanity. That's the core description of what being black means to me. Yeah, maybe you see something differently. And so I see and I criticize, I challenge our institutions and businesses and foundations who continue to, I think, not fully engage and support the genius and the leadership and the commitment that comes out of black people and black institutions. There's a questioning, you know, and the questioning often tries to pose that somebody else can do the job of serving black people better than black people can. Am I making sense at all?
No, I totally understand what you're, and when you, your definition of black people is my definition also. And working at Sabathany, it kind of speaks towards that.
I mean, I don't know anybody black that doesn't have white people in their family.
There you go, exactly.
I mean, you know, that's the deal.
Exactly.
You got a son or a daughter, a cousin,
right,
or a dad,
right,
or mom. Somebody in your family is probably, you know, from England or France or Poland or Sweden,
exactly,
you know.
But it's the experiences.
And it's okay.
Right.
And it's not a problem.
It's the experience. I was speaking with a Latino person that they were probably 25, mm-hmm, and they had recently graduated from college. Mm-hmm. And so we were speaking about, hey, we want to expand our youth program. And we were talking with her, and we said, why do you think we should expand the youth program to at least 18 or 19? And she said, well, for instance, I went to Wayzata, and my counselor told me I shouldn't go to college. Mm-hmm. So, and that story happened to me when I went to Minneapolis Washburn. Mm-hmm. So then how many people hear that story and they don't have anyone supporting them or providing them motivation and what have you? That's what our institutions do. We provide that motivation and excitement and opportunity and accessibility when some of the standards might say, you know what, college isn't for you, or this training program's not for you, mm-hmm, because of these other issues that are going on. What we do is we dive into those issues, try to you know, make sure that there's no obstacles, like our training program or what have you. If daycare is an obstacle, we want to have services where we can assist with the daycare. Mm-hmm. If transportation is an obstacle, we want to have you know, something where we have bus passes to illustrate to people how to get around the obstacles. So very important to have our services and to provide that motivation. If I did it, you can do it too.
Mm-hmm. We're going to take a break again and ask Stephen Belton to join us. He's the leader of a companion organization, the Minneapolis Urban League. I'm Al McFarland. This is Conversations with Al McFarland. Be back in a second. I'm Al McFarland. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarland. Joined now by Stephen Belton. He's the interim president and CEO of Minneapolis Urban League. And Stephen, before you joined us, I was sharing with Jonathan and Cindy this perception that I have and that I present as a journalist of the value, the strength, and the work of legacy institutions, Urban League, Sabathany, MLK, Hallie Hugh Brown. I think that these institutions are the pillars of our community, and I decry efforts to marginalize the work and the value that you bring to our community. I wanted to give you a minute to talk about the Urban League. It's a historic freedom fighting, economic development resource for black people. Talk about the Urban League.
First, let me say that it's also historic to have the heads of the Sabathany Community Center and MLK, Alec Hugh Brown, and the Urban League sitting at the same table. Even though we work together, support each other, and I have to say that having been raised in this community, Sabathany was an important part of my upbringing, as was Hallie Hugh. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes people like to think that there's a divide between St. Paul and Minneapolis and between North Minneapolis and South Minneapolis, but I'm human testimony that there was no divide. We had services, we used to swim out of Hallie Hugh. We used to hang out at Hallie Hugh, went to those little teen dances. Mm-hmm. Same thing, I actually went to Bryant Junior High School which is the building that is now Sabathany. And even as a young person coming back from college, once it had become Sabathany, used to go up there to look for jobs, would find jobs. My family used the food shelf up there. And so when you talk about legacy, you're talking about integral part of a community, part of the fabric of the community life. The Urban League is another one of those institutions. My first job out of college, I went to the Urban League. That's where you went if you're looking for a job. And it wasn't just a job, blue collar jobs. I was, you know, expecting what every black kid who went to college was told, that you get that education, boy, and doors will open up for you. So I went to the Urban League to see where the doors would open up. Mm-hmm. And the Urban League has been one of those institutions in our community that has always been there, has been a pillar. It actually started in the Twin Cities 89 years ago, but is a national organization about 100 years. And it started after the Great Migration being when black people started moving from the segregation of Jim Crow in the South to factory jobs in Gary, Indiana, and Chicago, and jobs on the railroad in Minneapolis and St. Paul, and in the flour mills. And so the Urban League was there as the urban in its name was a way to translate the urban experience to these rural black folks. These are country boys, country girls, coming up here on the train and on the bus and on, you know, on the back of pickup trucks. And they, Stevie Wonder has that great song, Living Just for the City, where he's talking about New York City, just like I pictured it. You know, that was our experience, kind of a hayseed experience and culture coming up and needing an organization that could help translate the whens, wheres, and whens, and the hows. And it's interesting that, you know, almost 100 years later, we're still doing that. Because you got black folk who come here from other parts of the country and don't understand the Minnesota experience. They need to know, sisters need to know, where do I get my hair did? Mm-hmm. You know, brothers want to know, you know, where's the haircut? Where can I get faded, you know? Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's so we're still doing a lot of that work. But our principal work now is on empowering African Americans and empowering Africans. We talk about the language that we use at the Urban League is really African descendants. So that encompasses both the immigrant community, but also African Americans, people who were born in this country. And our job is to find and promote pathways to prosperity. We used to talk about pathways out of poverty, but it's not enough simply to get out of poverty. There's so much space in that out of poverty that is not prospering. And so we believe that part of the American dream, part of what we are entitled to, part of the promise of hope and liberty is prosperity. And we don't define prosperity only economically, although that certainly is a significant piece of it. But we are working on housing, we work on college readiness, we work on employment and workforce development, we're working on entrepreneurship, and we're working on asset and wealth accumulation and in health. And so it's a broad spectrum that defines our prosperity. And the Urban League has been in the middle of that for a very long time and will continue to be in the middle of that for a very long time.
We talked earlier, and I said that I mentioned to you as well, this pernicious movement against legacy institutions in the black community. There's been this willingness to question the value of Urban Leagues, of Hallie Q, of Sabathany, and the code there is questioning the value of black leadership and the questioning the value of us bringing solutions to our community and laying a claim on the public treasury in particular, and also foundation resources that have some of their generation, their creation from our patronage as consumers, right? And so how do you see that? I heard you talk recently, maybe it was on one of my programs, about right now it's like Minneapolis and St. Paul is in a modern apartheid state.
Yes.
Expand on that.
Well, we're in an apartheid state. An apartheid regime is one in which assets and resources provision is based on race. And so if you look at the disparities that we have, that African Americans have in income, in wealth, in housing, in health, in access to health care, in education, we have two different cities. It's a tale of two cities. We live in an unseen city here. We call it a shadow Minnesota. And living in the shadows is very different than what it is for white people. And so just as one example, the median family income for African Americans is $27,000. That's the median family income. I think most people agree, while there are a number of people who would love to have $27,000, most people agree that that is, in this economy, in this state with the cost of living, that's inadequate, particularly if you're trying to raise a family of individuals on that income. So $27,000 for African Americans. The income for the median income for whites in Minnesota is $68,000. And so you're talking about 140% difference for African Americans. And so for every dollar that an African American makes, essentially you're talking about, you know, white folks make, you know, $1.75. And so it's a significant difference. It also is a penalty that we pay. It's kind of the black tax. And so you not only, when I was growing up, the mantra was, and I bet Cindy, you heard the same thing, and I know you heard the same thing, Jonathan, that you have to work twice as hard. So now, you know, you have to work twice as hard, they would say, to get half as much as white folks get. Now we have to work twice as hard, and we're still getting less. We're still getting a whole lot less. And so that's the apartheid regime we're talking about. Your point about, you know, the attack on legacy institutions, it's really an attack on our legacy leaders as well. The irony of that is that it is coming from the majority community, but it's also the majority community is speaking through certain members of the African-American community who ironically are standing on the shoulders of those very leaders that they challenge. And so they give no recognition of the history. I understand that. Don't fault them for that. I wish they'd stop. But the truth is, it's an old game in which is to divide and conquer. They would have us believe that we've got beef with each other, that African Americans within our own community, that our leaders are beefing with each other. It's an old divide and conquer. If they can divert us with energy, with time, with strategy on trying to attack each other, then we're not gonna do anything for each other. And so I wish them well. I wish they would stop. I wish they'd focus on the fact that we are all in the same boat. Some of us have our hand on the rudder. Some of us are pulling oars. Some of us got the light and trying to say, avoid that rock. You know, some of us are pulling in the water, trying to swim and push us along. But we are all in the same boat. We are all trying to move this vehicle called the African-American community in the same direction, and really don't have time for, you know, these sort of side swipes and games that some people are invested in playing.
I think what's happening too, Stephen Belton, is that voices like yours are presenting a new clarity, a new reflection of the longstanding conviction that our plight is one that is winnable.
Yes.
Not our plight, but our road, yeah. You know, is and our path is, and the challenge that we are worthy of it, and that we intend to win. And so having that attitude and that voice means that we go to the market to both our friends and foes and describe the reality that we are building. And I hear you presenting that without fear. Does that make sense to you?
It does. Mm-hmm. In fact, I would say our narrative is one that we speak for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact is that, you know, despite only earning, you know, $27,000 versus $68,000. We still got mothers raising their children and sending them off to college, insisting that they go to school, insisting that they learn sports so they can learn teamwork and learn how to contribute mm-hmm. to a whole or something greater than themselves. We still have families and neighborhoods reclaiming their neighborhoods, still saying this is going to be a safe place and this is going to be a drug-free zone right here. We still got folks who get up every Sunday and go to worship
mm-hmm.
and praising God and giving God thanks mm-hmm. for what God has done in their lives. And so we are a hopeful and a resilient people. Yes, we have challenges.
Mm-hmm.
We've had challenges for 200 years of chattel slavery, followed by 85 years of Jim Crow and segregation,
mm-hmm.
followed by a failed post-civil rights era that got us the laws but didn't get us the relief. And so we've come through all of that in history with a sense of trauma, and we certainly are a traumatized people, but still we're able to get up, as my grandmother used to say, clothed in my right mind, ready to move forward into the next day.
And that's one of the places I think our institutions really play a key part. When you're trying to mitigate that 27,000 versus that 68,000, our institutions are the ones that have the food shelves, that have the programs, that do the training, that can help connect people to resources and help the families get through that path. And also be the ones to help explain the situation. Mm-hmm. One of the greatest misconceptions is that somehow because you're in these situations that that's the way it is. We earned it. We're supposed to make 27,000. We're supposed to be less. And most people do not understand the legacy of slavery, the legacy of Jim Crow, and the institutionalized racism that exists within centers of government, within corporate institutions, within our communities, that some people don't even realize. They go ahead and they perpetuate the stereotypes, they perpetuate the practices, and they're not even conscious of the fact that they're playing right into that system. We're able to bring that information forward and say, let me help you understand that this is like a relay race. And throughout this relay race, black people have been carrying white people throughout that relay race for the first half of it. And then the white people get off the shoulders and you're told, okay, now you should be able to keep up with the white person who's rested, who you've been carrying the whole time, and you should go ahead and run at the same pace. It's impossible. And so as we look towards what the future can bring, it's much more about education. It's much more about making people aware. It's showing the value that every one of the people that walks through our doors knows. They're not caring about policy. They're not caring about, you know, what a politician is saying. They're caring that their family's hungry. They're caring that they're caring that they can't find some place to sleep that night. They're caring that they're trying to find a job. And when they come out of one of our institutions, they come out with that job, with that food, with that connection to a place to live. And that is the difference that we make in their lives.
I'm Al McFarland. This is Conversations with Al McFarland. We'll continue in a minute my conversation with Cindy Booker at Sabathany Community Center, Jonathan Palmer, Hallie Q. Brown Community Center in St. Paul, and Stephen Belton, Minneapolis Urban League in Minneapolis. I want to, in the break, have you all think about how we struggle, how we ramp up the struggle. I think we're in a special place. I think we're at a watershed place. I think the dam's about to break. I think we've taken all we can take on the one hand. We also know that our strengths and our gifts, our skills are real. I think we've moved past the point of doubting who we are and questioning whether we deserve. I think we have to decide, and we are deciding, that we will be clear, we'll be coordinated, we'll be collaborative, and we will take our place at the table of decision in community and in society. And in doing so, we will benefit our people and we will benefit the world. Think about that. We'll come back in a second. I'm Al McFarland. McFarland, welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarland. I'm pleased to continue the conversation with Stephen Belton. He's the CEO, interim CEO of the Minneapolis Urban League, with Jonathan Palmer, CEO of Hallie Q. Brown Community Center in St. Paul, and with Cindy Booker, CEO of Sabathany Community Center, all legacy institutions. I wanted to take, before the break, I talked about how do we move forward aggressively and with confidence to build our organizations and to serve our community, believing that the building we do really builds the entire society, the entire community. Cindy, what do you think?
Well, I think that, it's our time, like you said. Mm-hmm. It's our time to start really illustrating how we can work together. Mm-hmm. I know Steve and I, we've reached out to each other, and we are partnering on various opportunities. And mm-hmm. usually people will say, like Steve mentioned earlier, that north side, south side, mm-hmm. you never get along. Mm-hmm. But Steve and I have had a great working relationship, and we'll continue to partnership, make both organizations strong. Mm-hmm. But as different things happen in the community, I think funders, I think the state, I think representatives, they'll notice that they're going to need our support to get through this. I was speaking with someone today and they said, Cindy, I didn't realize until the recent incidents how important it is to get involved with the government. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize how it was important to speak with your city council person. So I think just, you kind of learn from your experiences, and we've had some not so good experiences, but what's great about that is that our community is learning what they need to do to make sure that we can eliminate various barriers and obstacles.
How do we avoid dissension inside our community, Jonathan and Steve? Dissension that at the end of the day has the effect, whether intended or not, of allowing people who hold the purse strings to step away, back away, and say, oh, you guys are arguing, so I'm not going to put the resources. We know the need is there, but you all can't seem to organize how to deliver goods and services, so we'll get somebody from Wayzata who can come and do what you're doing, and you know they do it kind of dispassionately. It's just a job for them. They do it and they go home.
Right. Well, so I think part of it is we have to recognize that some dissension, some disagreement is inevitable. Mm-hmm. The African American community is not monolithic.
Right.
You know, there's no one single leader. We don't all look the same. We don't all act the same. We don't worship all in the same places. We don't buy the same kind of cars, and we don't listen to the same kind of music. You got black folk who love rap, and some who love country music, and some who love classical. And so the expectation that we would all agree on strategic matters is simply unreasonable. There are going to be disagreements. In fact, the Bible says iron sharpens iron. And so it's okay to disagree. And it's okay. It's the point is to not let it be a distraction and to not allow it to denigrate into personal attacks to the point that people become disengaged from the entire process. Your point about this sort of setting back. But let's put this moment that we are in context. And so in October, we had released U.S. Census data that I alluded to before that essentially showed that the African-American community not only was behind the white community, not only was below, but had actually fallen back, fallen further behind. Significant piece there that has given us significant momentum to address this income disparity. And then 2 weeks ago, Jamar Clark is shot and killed. An unarmed young man who's apprehended by police, shot and killed. Not only shot and killed, but shot and killed in the streets where he lived, witnessed by an untold number of people. This has galvanized the community. Between the two, the data that we are way behind, and now you have an incident that underscores our vulnerability and the fact that to the majority population, at least to the bad police that are out there, and I am not condemning all police officers at all, I'm saying at least to the bad police who are allowed to work by a system in a system that is supported by our elected officials, those police treat us as though we are animals. In fact, worse than animals, because I don't think you shoot your beloved animal in the middle of the street. The community narrative is that Jamar Clark was unarmed. I think if there were that kind of question about a shooting in Wayzata or in Bryn Mawr or in Maple Grove, I think the community's interest in knowing the truth and in transparency would have outweighed any concern about what data practices may or may not provide, because the community deserves an answer. And so when you sandwich this data that says that we are second-class citizens, we're living in apartheid with a violent incident that is apartheid-like, then what you have is a community that's saying, we're not going to take this. We ended apartheid in South Africa. We're going to end it in Minneapolis as well.
Jonathan, what do you think?
Well, and it becomes a galvanizing point. One of the struggles with that is being able to agree to disagree. As Steve said, you know, we're not all going to agree with the same thing. And there's nothing wrong with having that disagreement. And when it fractures to the point that if you disagree, somehow you are bad, evil, the enemy, sellout, anything along those lines, that's not productive dialogue. It's okay to disagree. It's okay to be on the opposite side of an issue and still have intellectual discussion and debate. And that's what keeps people from walking away from the table. You know, what is incumbent upon us is to make sure that we're focused on what the key issues are, not what the distractions are, not the things that people will use to pull you away from the main focus of the issue, and actually stay there. And having committed leadership that does that, having people being on the same page with the ability to disagree, is the only way that we can move forward cohesively as a community, I think.
You know, Steve, I keep remembering that I heard you on a radio show a few days ago talking about Jeffrey Hassan, or either he was on talking about you. But the conversation was that you guys were in school together as third or fourth graders. And
Jeff's like 10 years older than me.
He was just slow, huh? He's retarded, right?
He was really slow. I was really fast.
Okay. Well, the beauty of the conversation to me was recognizing the vestedness of your presence. And so I said, man, you know, he's talking about where they were back in the neighborhood in the fifth grade over in Minneapolis at the time. They spent together in St. Paul. It was a good story, but it let me know that you've got deep roots here, and you've got the book, you've got the story of how this community has emerged. And that story often isn't presented enough, solemnized in a way that people can grab it, visualize it, recite it, and use it as a benchmark for where we gotta go. Mm-hmm. There's always this institutional amnesia.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
The Minneapolis Public Schools 20 years ago embarked on a campaign to have something happen so that every kid at that year would be graduating in 12 years, right? Mm-hmm. About 10 years in, everybody forgot about that. Let's start over. Yeah. Northwest Area Foundation announced a campaign to put $10 million in the North of Minneapolis to solve poverty, right? And 2 or 3 years in the process, they changed their mind. Mm-hmm. And so these institutions have the luxury and the arrogance to change their mind, to walk away, and we are left hoping for somebody else to come with another solution with money. How do we fix that? How do we not be always at the mercy, and how do we find our way to exercising decisions and power in places that make a difference so that we get the results we need and that our results reflect awareness, knowledge of our history, of the conditions, but also the triumphs, you know, and our likelihood to continue to triumph?
Well, I think one of the things that has to happen is that we need to say, no more studying us. I think we need to declare a moratorium on being in the fishbowl. And I'm not trying to, I believe in research, and I'm particularly am dedicated to returning the Urban League's research capacity so that we can drive public policy. But I'm saying the folks who want to come in and study us just to see what's under our rock, so to speak, is unhelpful. And the folks who want to come in and tell us how to save ourselves and how to fix ourselves, those strategies are no longer effective and should no longer be welcome. Mm-hmm. We need to, again, this is part of reclaiming our own narrative, Al. We need to say, as part of our narrative, we want to drive the decision making, we wanted to drive the policy making, we wanted to drive the strategies for what is helpful to us. I was thinking about your point about the Minneapolis Public Schools. I don't think anybody ever asked the children in that district, you know, if that's a goal that they wanted. Did they ask the parents in that district, is this something that you want? Because they may have said, you know, graduating in time in 12 years is one thing, and that's important, but I'd really like is to make sure that my kid can read, to make sure that my kid knows how to balance a checkbook, to make sure that my kid understands what science, some basic science. That might have been what they said, but graduation, simply for the sake of graduation, is not an effective strategy, and it isn't something that is of value in our community. Simply having a credential, that's not the credential we want. The credential we want is a life that's committed and it is capable of making a contribution back to our community. That's what our communities, we want to raise valuable citizens, contributing citizens who are using their God-given talents to the best of their ability. And the credential isn't about that.
And part of the value that we play is that network, mm-hmm. that helps people connect into. You know, Steve said that he had an Urban League story. I have an Urban League story, which is, you know, back in 1989, I was struggling, trying to figure out what I wanted to do with my life. It was after my sophomore year of college at Morehouse. I came up here and mentored under my uncle Gleason Glover, and worked here and fell in love with the president of the Urban League for 26 years.
That's right.
And it's what touched my heart and got me into this work and got me into doing the kinds of stuff we do. And I want to just say that I think my uncle would be proud of the work that Steve is doing. I think he would be proud of him as head. It may be interim, but it should be full. But I think he would be very proud of the legacy that he's carrying on. I think Steve is doing an excellent job. I think Cindy is also doing a wonderful job. And our institutions working together can help keep those networks, connect people to each other, and connect our community so that that degree is not just a credential. It is a gateway to the next step and to a career of success.
So here's what I think. I think that somehow we've got to create a public understanding, a public awareness of the value system that your institutions represent. And the value system includes things like, you weren't here yet, I told him my Sabathany story, is I met my wife at Sabathany, right? You know, and we still married, you know, that's a good thing, right? But all these relationships and all these nurturing experiences and all of these things you have access to, all of the, I got some of my first employees from the Urban League through the MEAD program. When I got the business started, the Urban League brought me workers that subsidized these people's work to help me grow my business. Yeah. And so the institutions you represent have a critical role to play for business, for social, for personal, for health, and other things. So somehow, I want to figure out what it takes to triple, quadruple the revenue streams that you all command. I think that's not unreasonable. I think that if your budget is $5 or $6 million now, it ought to be $30-40 million. And that we ought to figure out a way to aggregate money and capital inside true, tried, tested, credible, transparent, well-run organizations like Sabathany, like the Urban League, like MLK, Hallie Q. Brown, and that these places are places that can also generate more business and more solutions, more education for our people. What do you think? Could that happen? Would you accept that if it happened?
Oh. No, we don't want more resources or money or things. I think it definitely could happen. I think it is something that it is incumbent upon one us to help. And when I say us, I'm talking about the community. To be able to raise up that flag and say, these are the places that have value. We want to see these supported. We will go ahead and support them. We talk about patronizing black businesses and black institutions, and we need to do that, but also not expect a discount, not expect to get the hookup with that, because they're trying to grow. Support them because they're trying to grow. Help go ahead and connect the resources. If I see a grant out there that is for workforce, we don't do workforce. So I'm gonna call these two and say, hey, here's this grant out there. You guys should take a look at this and see if it's something that fits. Looking at the institutions that support, having them understand that we work on the same page, that we may be in different geography, but we see the same people, we work on the same issues, and if Steve gets a grant or Cindy gets a grant, I'm not mad at that. I'm glad at that because it helps support their institution. It's not competition, it's cooperation. And that's the way that I think we can move us ahead.
I think about how President Obama led the ARRA, the American Reinvestment was a strategy, American, I can't think of the name of what it stands for now, but you know what I mean. And but massive investment in industries that were at risk. It seems to me a massive investment in institutions, not that they're at risk, but at their capacity to deliver value to our community.
Some are at risk. Yeah. We've got, I won't, but I could give you, tick off the names of legacy institutions in Minneapolis and St. Paul right now that are, you know, hanging by a thread. I know, and some of them are at risk. And it's not a question of bad management or of improper funding. It's a question of, it's a matter of the funding drying up, the commitment to these organizations drying up. There's a couple of things that I think that we can do specifically, Al. One is our government organizations, particularly because we receive a lot of federal, city, and county money, they need to start funding innovation. What they tend to fund is the same old, or stay in the course. And stay in the course is not working because the disparities alone establish that they're not working. So they need to develop a risk profile, and they need to become, they are now risk adverse. That's the nature of governmental entities. They have to look after the taxpayers' coffers, but this is a time to be able to fund innovation, to find works. Tie metrics to it, tie research to it, do best practices, but allow that to happen. And it also needs to be indigenously directed. That is to say, don't come in and tell me what to do. Allow innovation to occur so that we can use the resourcefulness, the innovation in our own communities to say, this is what will work. A second thing is that our philanthropic organizations need to start funding us consistent with our representation in the population. So as an example, in Hennepin County, you know, about 12%, Ramsey County, similar percentages there. Why aren't the funding organizations, our philanthropic organizations, directing 12% of their grant making? We're talking about over $1 billion mm-hmm. a year. I ought to be happy with 2% of that. Mm-hmm. It ought to be a mm-hmm. representation of what we're getting, but we're not getting that. Another part of that is, what about an endowment? When's the last time you heard, well, I'll just tell you, never have you heard of somebody saying, I'm leaving $25 million to Sabathia's. Cindy would have told me about it. Jonathan would have said that. But there's no endowment for our organizations, and yet for the Guthrie, yep. for the Walker, love these institutions, yep. great institutions. All of these, you know, Orchestra Hall, yeah, even the hospitals, you know, huge endowments, yeah, people write checks for $5 million, $25 million. But if we ask for a $25 membership, we're challenged.
Listen, we're out of time. This is a great conversation. We got to do it again. I thank you all so much for being here, for being in this conversation. Cindy Booker, leader at Sabathany Community Center, Jonathan Palmer, Hallie Hugh Brown, Community Center in St. Paul, and Stephen Belton, Minneapolis Urban League. Legacy Institutions, thank you so much. I'm Al McFarland. We'll see you next time.
Programming is supported by UCARE, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCARE, healthcare that starts with you.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We want to thank Al McFarland for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Cause this thing is safe. The message is clear. Everybody knows we gotta keep it nice clear.